while you're asleep, have shoes by your bed, have a jacket, have a flashlight nearby, because one of the biggest injuries that actually, most common injuries that happens during earthquake is cut feet, because there's glass on the floor.
Hi, I'm Scott Leadingham. Thanks for joining us here in the unique Northwest. Have you heard of the Cascadia Mega-Quake? You probably have. It's been talked about for a long time in the Northwest. And are you ready for it? Well, emergency managers certainly hope you are, or they're trying to help you get ready. That's why on October 17th, there's the Great Shakeout Drill that is happening across the region, including with broadcast stations such as this one. And Courtney Flatt has been in the region reporting on it as of late, and she went to a recent public meeting in Richland to see what was being talked about and how emergency managers are communicating with the general public. Thanks for joining us today, Courtney.
Thanks for having me.
Courtney, tell us a little bit about what you encountered at that meeting in Richland and what some of the people were learning.
Sure, yeah. So the meetings were really focused on the east side of the Cascades. And so what they kind of said was that when the big one happens, the tremors and the shakes won't be remotely as bad east of the Cascades, and will likely be more of kind of a first stop for refugees, people who are hurt and needing help. But kind of closer to home, one thing that was interesting to find out is that there are several fault lines east of the Cascades that are concerning to geologists, nothing like what will be happening off the coast, but faults that could do damage one day. And so some of the areas that they're kind of looking at and studying, there's a fault line that runs through Richland and Kennewick, one near Walla Walla, a few near Ellensburg and Yakima, if you can picture like the Saddle Mountain or Tandem Ridge, Rattlesnake Ridge. Those areas were all formed by uplifted by faults, and so you can kind of picture where they might be in that area, that region. There's also a fault line that runs through or near Chelan, and it's the one that has most recently erupted in 1872. It was a 6.8 magnitude earthquake, and right now they have noticed kind of what they call nests of earthquakes in that area. They're really tiny earthquakes that you really can't even feel, but they're just kind of watching that. And so they're still studying these fault lines. They're still kind of learning about them. There's still fault lines that are being discovered in this region and being mapped. And so ultimately, they hope that one day they'll be able to predict exactly like what percentage of will happen, how big of a chance you'll have for one of these fault lines to erupt soon. They're not there yet, but they're working on figuring that all out.
Side note, one thing that you say there, erupt, that often comes to mind with the volcanoes, which we certainly have in the region as well, but never really kind of hear that with fault lines.
Yeah,
that's interesting. Yeah.
You said ruptured, but yeah.
One thing that also comes to mind is the aspect of infrastructure, how that will hold up. We hear a lot about buildings shaking and freeway overpasses crumbling, more so perhaps on the west side of the state, but on the east side of the Cascades, where many people are in the line of, for example, dams, a huge part of the infrastructure and economy, frankly, of eastern and central Washington. What are emergency managers saying about how dam infrastructure and similar things like that might hold up? I just, for example, grew up in Grand Coulee, literally at the foot of the Grand Coulee Dam. And we always thought, what kind of quake would take out that thing, right? Are we ready for that?
Yeah, so the dams were built before engineers knew about the Cascadia subduction zone off the coast. But that being said, the Army Corps of Engineers doesn't really expect the dams to fail so badly that the reservoirs will spill out or anything like that. There could be kind of cracks in the concrete maybe, or seepage if there's a really huge earthquake, those closer to the rupture of the earthquake could see some of that, but they're not really concerned that much about big major failures of dams. That's what they're thinking now. They do seismic studies every 15 years, and so I think the most recent one was around 2010, 2011, so there'll be some coming up fairly soon, I guess.
One thing we hear about often with earthquake preparedness and just natural disaster and other emergency preparedness in general is this idea of being 2 weeks ready, and it certainly doesn't apply, again, just to people who are on the west side of the Cascades. So on the east side of the Cascades, in Tri-Cities area, Pullman, Moscow, everywhere else, where should, how should people prepare, and what are emergency managers saying about what to have in your preparedness kit?
Yeah, they definitely want you to have a kit. They were passing out these little flyers to tell you what you need in there. So you definitely need, some of the most important things would be like a first aid kit, flashlight, food and water for 2 weeks. And so the water is 1 gallon per person per day. And that's not anywhere near the amount of water that we actually use. That's just would be for drinking and cooking and stuff, I think. And with food, they want you to check expiration dates annually that are in your kit. Any medications you have. One thing that I found interesting that they suggested to put in there is like a comfort item or entertainment. So like a deck of cards, or maybe you have a little kid who has a teddy bear, because you don't know how long you'll be away from home and needing just items to kind of have a little bit of normalcy. And then another thing that was, that I had never thought of before, but they said to designate somebody outside of the state that all of your family members can call and let them know ahead of time that they have been designated this person. So maybe you have an uncle in Minnesota or something, and you can then call them, and maybe the earthquake hits while you're at school and your parents are at work, then the uncle can coordinate where everybody is and help you kind of find each other. So that was kind of interesting. And then another thing that they say you should do is to, while you're asleep, have shoes by your bed, have a jacket, have a flashlight nearby, because one of the biggest injuries that actually, most common injuries that happens during earthquake is cut feet, because there's glass on the floor. And so if it happens while you're asleep, you'll be able to put on your shoes and not have cut feet that you have to walk places to get help with.
Side note, I think everyone has a nice uncle in Minnesota. So thank you in advance, Uncle Ted. Or whatever your uncle's name is. Courtney, thank you so much for sharing this information with us today. It's very helpful.
Thank you.
And for more on this topic, we turn to Enrique Perez de la Rosa in Yakima, who's been looking at some angles such as the large amount of non-English speakers, or people for whom English is not their first language, in Eastern and particularly Central Washington. Enrique has been looking at that. So tell us, how have emergency management agencies and counties kind of prepared for that, if at all? For example, there's a lot of H-2A farm workers who come seasonally from Mexico and Central America. How are they going to be communicated with?
Yeah, that's right. And with H-2A workers in particular, I think the employers, they're responsible for housing and for transportation. They're also responsible for communicating with workers if there's an emergency. That said, there's still a very large Spanish-speaking population here in Yakima. The county is actually required by law to prepare and create a limited English proficiency plan for populations that reach 5% of the county's population. The county is responsible and required by law to create a plan to reach out to these communities in the language that they speak. For some counties like Yakima, it's pretty simple. They have to address a Spanish-speaking population primarily. For a county like King County, they have to address 30 communities in their language. So it differs from county to county, depending on the population that lives there.
So are there examples of counties in Washington that are doing this particularly well at the moment? You mentioned, you know, you're in Yakima County, and you mentioned on the west side, King County, which has many different languages. But in particularly Central Washington or others, I'm thinking of maybe like even California, which has, you know, a lot of different populations such as this. Are there examples of ones who have put a lot of resources into this topic at the moment?
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned California, because both in California and in Washington, it was wildfires that really kind of sparked this conversation about how you reach especially Spanish-speaking populations. But again, this is an issue that impacts every person that doesn't speak English quite well enough to be in touch with emergency services. And so there's several counties that have actually the 5% threshold that counties have to meet. That was spurred by a law change from 2015 after wildfires then. And Chelan County was part of a pilot program then to create a plan to sort of address that problem. Grant County, they've recently hired a PIO, which speaks Spanish, to be able to communicate with people and translate materials. So there is some progress being made. There's a few different ways that it can be done, by hiring staff, by recruiting volunteers to translate materials. But it is a big issue because it's a huge undertaking for these small emergency management teams.
You mentioned small emergency management teams, but these counties are geographically pretty large. And so I wonder if part of the issue that we're seeing here is that county level emergency managers and sheriff's departments are tasked with patrolling and keeping safety across these wide geographic areas, but with relatively smaller populations, especially compared to counties on the west side of the state. And in so doing, they don't have as much tax revenue because they have a large geographic area, but a small number of people, smaller tax base. And because of that, they can't physically just hire the amount of staffers they need because they don't have the resources. Is that really what's going on?
That's exactly right. I keep mentioning King County because they have 30 languages that they have to sort of manage, but they have a very broad tax base to, you know, get the resources they need to address that problem. But for a place like Yakima County, which in the east side is a pretty populous county, they only have 4 people in the emergency management team that are tasked with doing this. And as I understand it, they don't speak Spanish. So they rely on volunteers and people in the community to help them connect with the community in their language when it comes to preparedness and in emergency situations. So it is a huge undertaking. In some counties, it's even less than 4 people. I've heard of teams of 1 person, not really a team, but just 1 person that's tasked with coordinating emergency management efforts in a county because they don't really have that many people to begin with, and they can't get more people on board because they don't have the resources necessarily.
Well, Enrique, we thank you for sharing that information with us. And just by way of notation, you are a Spanish speaker. So if people need information on news or other information, you are there to help the people of Central Washington. Thank you so much for joining us today, Enrique.
Thank you.
For more resources on emergency management and the great shakeout exercise in preparing for the big earthquake, come to our website, nwpb.org. Thank you for joining us here in the unique Northwest.